Welcome back, baseball fans. Summer 69-72 carryover league. Gotta turn this down a little bit. I don't want to be talking that loud. Okay. Sorry about that. Welcome to the National League Championship Series between the New York Mets and the San Francisco Giants. Let's take a look at how these teams got here this year. We're going to look to the postseason. First of all, let's go back to the postseason tournament where the top-seeded teams played each other for overall seeding. This is where the genesis of the Mets begins. So the Mets dominated a Las Vegas team 3-0, while the Dodgers got dominated by the Reds 3-0. So the Mets moved into the number two seed. Actually, all those teams, Boston, the Angels, the Reds, and the Mets, they went 10-0 to demand, we want a seed. We want a high seed. We saw the Tigers beat the Angels. That didn't work out. And we saw the Dodgers beat the Reds. Could the Mets buck the trend? They have the number two seed. Now, the Giants, how do they get here? In the National League West, the Dodgers and the Giants were in a virtual tie. Percentage points separating them, but the Dodgers won head-to-head twice. They beat them 4 out of 7 and then 4 out of 6 before and after the All-Star break. So the Dodgers get the number three seed. Didn't help them. They got eliminated. So the Giants take a wild card into here, into Las Vegas, beat them 3-1. And then if you saw the San Francisco Giants Cincinnati divisional round series, I highly recommend you watch the video published on, I think, September the 3rd on Friday of last week or so. Yeah, it's just a magnificent series, knocking the Reds out. So the Giants are red hot. The series is in Shea Stadium. The Mets know that if they go to the World Series, they will host, the National League team hosts the World Series, and we know that they would face the Detroit Tigers in the World Series. Let's not get too far ahead of ourselves. Let's look at the pitching matchups next for this series. Here we are down here. And magnificent here. We have Kuzman. It was like a coin flip between Kuzman and Seaver. But Kuzman's been pitching better this year. And I gave Kuzman the number one spot in the league championship series. Seaver, if they advance, might have it in the World Series, so who knows. But Kuzman gets the top spot against Marichal. Game two, it'll be Seaver against Ron Bryant, big advantage Mets. And then the young guns, John Matlack and Sam McDowell in game three. Then a day off, and then we roll it back again. Kuzman, Marichal, Seaver, Bryant, Matlack, McDowell in games 4, 5, and 6 if necessary. And in game seven, if necessary, folks, Don Cardwell, the number four starter and the New York Met bullpen against Dean Chance, number four starter and the Giant bullpen, and possible cameo individual innings pitched by these previous three pitchers. So that's what we're looking for here in the National League Championship Series, starting in Shea Stadium. Game one, Kuzman, Marichal. We've talked long and lovingly about Juan Marichal this year. Let's see what happened in game one. Quickly in the bottom of the first, a Joe Foy double, a walk by Garrett, an error by Chris Spire loads the bases, and then number four hitter Kenny Singleton, having a marvelous 1970 rookie year, hits into a double play, but it scores a run. And then with two outs, Tommy A.G. singles, and then gets thrown out stealing. But it's 2-0 Mets, quickly off Marichal. Top of the second, Ken Henderson, it's a homer off Kuzman, it's 2-1. Bottom of the second, a Clendenon double. RBI single by Grody, and the Mets are going, Juan who? Mara shut? Mara what? It's 3-1. Then in the third inning, a single by Cleon Jones, and that guy, Ken Singleton, 1970, hit 263. He's hitting 349 in the carryover league, folks. Almost 100 points over his Strat card. He is riding the magic carpet for the Mets this year, helping the Mets get to this particular spot. 5-2 off Marichal. They get another run. And that's it. 5-2. And the Mets, they're looking at this on paper going, man, we got these guys. Tug McGraw closes the game out of the ninth inning. And we talked about McGraw a lot in the Dodgers series. Didn't match up well with the Dodgers, didn't matter, because the Dodgers have all these lefties. And McGraw, that screwball, gets knocked around by lefties pretty much, but not righties, of course. Well, the Giants only have one lefty in the entire team. Willie McCovey. They got some switch hitters, that's it. So, McGraw gets his first save of what the Mets hope is many in this series. And they get game one in Shea. And it's looking like Miracle Mets here, folks. It's looking really good for them. So what happens in game two? Game two, Tom Seaver versus Ron Bryant. Some sloppy defense. A single off of the Seaver card. An error off of the Clendenon card. Unearned run. It's one zip. But in the fifth inning, Mets magic. A double by Foy. An error by Ron Bryant, an error by one of the E37 third basemen the Giants have. Take your pick. It was Fuentes this time, but him, Jim Hart, and Jose Herrera are all E37s. Really bad baseball defensively in game two. The Mets string together singles and walks and errors and get four gift runs. Seaver, though, isn't particularly sharp. He kept the ball in the park, though. That was very important here in the sixth inning. A triple, a walk, and then this guy, Ron Hunt, who does not have power against right-handed pitching, one of the few hitters on the Giants who doesn't, and Ron Hunt is the only second baseman on this team. He rolls 4-4 off Seaver, would have been a three-run homer to give the Mets the lead, but it's only a single. Flash forward to the eighth inning, two on, Ron Hunt, you guessed it, folks, 4-4. You put a guy with power in the seventh spot in the Giants lineup, that's seven runs off Tom Seaver, and the Giants win this game. Instead, it's a brutal loss, another brutal loss from the Giants, 6-5. And suddenly, that magic fairy dust the Giants had against the Cincinnati Reds seems to be slipping through their fingers here. Tom Seaver, not particularly sharp, gets a win. This time, Seaver has to pitch an inning and two-thirds. We're going to watch his innings pitch count from the series. I don't want to overwork him and abuse him. So, the series goes across the coast with the Mets happily up 2-0. Somewhat surprising, but they are a favorite here. They have home field, and they're feeling very confident. And the thing about the Mets, they really have a surprisingly good offense. I mean, A.G., Singleton, Jones, Clendenon, Foy, Garrett, Cranepool, they're all pretty darn good hitters. It's just, you know, you got Harrelson and Grody who hit like 252. But this is a pretty potent Met team. This is not like the mid to late 70 Mets teams that couldn't hit a bull in the ass with a shovel. This is a good hitting Met squad. So let's go to Game 3 in Candlestick Park. Giants fans, cover your eyes. Mets go up 3-0 in Candlestick. And this is a really sad and unfortunate way to lose a baseball game if you're the San Francisco Giants and their fans. Bottom of one, you got John Matlack, the lefty, against Sam McDowell. Both lefties having great years. Matlack's a rookie, 72 card, a little shaky in the first. Three singles, Giants up one zip. In the third inning, a couple more singles and a sac fly. It's 2-0. Meanwhile, McDowell, he's perfect. Into the fourth inning. This Pat Corrales at bat. This is the Corrales is the DH, and this is the bizarre rule where the DH injures the pitcher by rolling a 6-12, meaning that the pitcher is somehow, I don't know, got a blister or a bad elbow or something. So instead of taking the pitcher out of the game, you could let him continue broken. And that's what they do because he's perfect at this point. We'll keep watching this. Into the fifth inning, the Giants load the base off Matlack, don't score. In the top of the sixth, McDowell walks a batter, but he stays in the game, has thrown six innings, broken for three with an injury. And this is where I kind of have to make a judgment as to am I cheating the Mets by leaving this guy in there when he shouldn't be pitching because he should be out of the game? but he's throwing a no-hitter with a walk. So we'll get into that. In the bottom of the sixth, though, an error by Foy, a walk, a single and a single, and Matlack is almost knocked out of this game, but then he gets the next three guys out, and it's 4-0. So this is what happens. Top of the seventh inning, 4-0 lead for Sam McDowell. The leadoff hitter is Corrales again, and he gets a clean single off McDowell to break up the no-no. And that's when I make the judgment call to take him out with the injury, figuring that he went an entire three innings and nine batters as an injured pitcher. So he comes out with a 4-0 lead and a runner at first and nobody out. And this, we've seen some great bullpens and some bad bullpens this year. We talked about how Don McMahon and Hamilton were blowing games for the Giants, so they went with Ken Wright in the seventh inning to save McMahon and Hamilton. The magic of Kenny Singleton, a double. Cleon Jones, double. Walk, walk, single, K, single. Mets take a 5-4 lead in the top of the seventh inning. And then it's about bullpens again. So, bottom of the seventh, Matlack. He gets the first guy out, and then I pull him. So both Matlack and McDowell were pulled. And a quick hook on Matlack. So as we have a righty, a lefty, a righty, righty, righty. So I go with Acosta, a righty who gets righties out. He mows down the next five batters. Bottom of the ninth, we get a switch hitting pinch hitter, Hallenier, only the third lefty on the team. And that means that Danny Frizzella, a righty who gets lefties out, is brought in and out, a fly ball, a walk. And it comes down to Willie McCovey, the winning run, 5-4 game, grounds it back to the mound. And suddenly, a cold shudder, the frigid San Francisco summer is not looking good anymore. The New York Mets are up 3-0, and they've won back-to-back one-run games, doing it with the bullpen, caught a great break on this injury. But this Tom McGraw has nothing to worry about except for McCovey. And McGraw does not have any homers against lefties on his card. So unless it's a one-run game, McGraw will just come on in games 4, 5, 6, and 7 if the Mets grab a lead. So that's what we got, folks. 3-0 Mets. They're not apologizing. They're happy as heck. And they're going for the sweep here in San Francisco after a day off. We rewind it back to the beginning. For the Mets, it'll be Jerry Kuzman, Juan Marichal. But before we get that started, I'm going to take a quick break. Okay, we are here for game four. Mets up 3-0. And Giants have the guy they want. The Mets have the guy they want. Jerry Kuzman on the hill. And the Giants will send, of course, Juan Marichal, the two-time Cy Young winner. No bigger moment in the last 2 years than now. He lost game one and is coming back on 3 days rest for game four. Joe Foy leads off for the Mets. 58, bounces to short. Today it's Spire. He's a 2E22 at short. And he makes the play. Wayne Garrett, 59, rolls a second. And Cleon Jones, 1-6, triple, 1-2, is a triple off the Cleon card. With two outs, it's Ken Singleton. 1-6! Let's take a look at Ken Singleton's card, folks. I'm going to leave it on the board for a while for you to gaze at this card for a second. Okay, so 1970, Ken Singleton, brought up for the Mets, has 198 at-bats. He hits .263, 8 doubles, and 5 home runs. What's really cool about this card as a switch hitter is all the power comes on one side with walks, and the batting average comes on the other side without power. And the Mets seem to dig this. He fits in nicely because he bats fourth cleanup against righties, And with all those singles, he bats third against lefties, setting the table for Cleon Jones, who bats fourth. He may, I don't think he'll get 198 at-bats, but right now he's hitting over 350 with a card that only hit 263 in 1970. And double 1-4 is a single, and he's now put his New York Mets 27 outs away from the World Series. So, something to think about. Tommy A.G., 67 is a K. All right, Jerry Kuzman on the mound against Ron Hunt. 38 is a hit by the pitch. Let's look at the Ron Hunt card. Always have to get this in whenever I get a Giants game in here. He actually, this is his 71 Expo card where he had the 50 hit by pitch to set a record. And it's a ton of them, folks. And he's on first base. The Giants shuffled their lineup after dropping three straight. Bonds is now batting sixth as more of a power hitter, as he has not been getting on a lot. And they're loading up the top of the lineup with three great on-base guys. Ron Hunt, Dick Dietz, and Willie Mays is now batting third, with McCovey batting cleanup. So if this is able to get the Giants going, they might run this thing back for as long as they are alive. So Dick Dietz, 1-4, flies a left. Willie Mays, 47 off Kuzman's a K. And with two outs, it's Willie McCovey. 2-5 is a walk. And with two outs, it's Ken Henderson. 48 is a strikeout. Top of two. Ed Cranepool, 65, skies the center. Clendenon, 110, short. I would have mentioned, too, that if the Mets don't have, and all the National League teams, there's no pitcher, so you get a designated hitter. The Mets are able to get Cranepool and Clendenon, two first basemen in the lineup. One is a DH. Something that a team needing offense like the Mets do benefit from. So having two everyday first basemen in your lineup certainly helps. Bud Harrelson, 46, is a base hit. With two outs, he's going to try a stolen base, and he is going to be safe. Runner at second for Jerry Grody. 1-9, flies a left. Bottom of two, Bobby Bonds, 2-4, center. Jose Herrera, 37, short. Tito Fuentes, 46, is a walk. And with two outs, it's Chris Spire, 66, single 1-11 off the Kuzman card. He rolls an 18 and lines out. We go to the third. It's Joe Foy, 57, is a K. Wayne Garrett, 1-6 is a K. And with two outs, it's Cleon Jones. 2-6 is a base hit. Beast Stealer, he will hold. And it's Ken Singleton. 1-3. That's going to be a base hit because you had to hold Cleon Jones at first and you roll the plus. You got runners on the corners. And it's Tommy A.G. 63, Marichal, short X. This is Spire, a 2 at short, and he makes the play. Giants get out of that. Bottom of third. Ron Hunt, 1-9. Grounds are short. Dick Dietz, 1-6 is a walk. Willie Mays, 6-12, center C. And with two outs, it's Willie McCovey. 45 is a fly ball to left. One zip in the fourth. Ed Cranepool, 1-8. Bouncer to short. Clendenon, 3-6. Let's take a look at Don Clendenon. Before you ask, this is not his 69 card that was so important in the World Series. He only hit 248 in 1969. This is his 70 card. He's much better. He hits 288 with 22 homers and 396 plate appearances. That's why I'm saying this Met team is very powerful, more powerful than you would think. That's a solo shot, and it's 2-0. Bud Harrelson, 2-7, another single. You got to be aggressive against Marichal. You have such few chances. So Harrelson's going to try another stolen base with one out. And this time he's thrown out. Probably not a smart move. And now it's two outs and it's Grody. And he grounds a second. So they got a little aggressive and cocky with a 2-0 lead. We go to the bottom of the fourth. It's Ken Henderson. 1-5. Let's take a look at Ken Henderson's card. Homer, 1-7, double, and that is gone. And we got a 2-1 game. Nice year in 70. 294, 17 bombs and 650 plate appearances. Bobby Bonds, 58, bouncer to second. We got Garrett, a 3E10 at second base, and that's a single off Garrett. Sloppy Mets here in the fourth. This is one of the things that the Mets have been doing to paralyze the Giants. Besides, we talked about Tug McGraw and no left-handed batters on the Mets. We also have the minus three armor Jerry Grody. So he completely shuts down the Giants' attempts to steal bases. So it'll be Jose Herrera, 35, single 1-17. He rolls a 19. Tito Fuentes, 66, single 1-11, a base hit. Two on, one out for Chris Spire. 37's a walk, and the bases are loaded. Abe Bunner, you got to bring it up in a 2-1 game. Ron Hunt is the batter. The pitch to Ron, 59. This is the shortstop. You can get the fielder's choice, no double play. So it's a force out at the plate for the road team. I'll let the home team get the double play on that one, 6-2-3. Road teams just get the fielder's choice at the plate. So he gets that. Reloads the bases with two outs for Dick Dietz. 54 off of the Kuzman card. Homer 1-9. Double. It's going to be a double. That'll score Fuente and Spire. Hunt, Ron Hunt will not run against the minus three arm of AG. So it's a two-run double. And this is one of the home field advantages. This could have been a 6-2-3 double play if it was in Shea Stadium. But what I do is, if I get that A with the infield up, I only let the home team turn the 6-2-3 double play. The road team, you get the fielder's choice at the plate, and the batter beats it out of first base. That came out to bite the Mets here. So it's 3-2 Giants with Willie Mays up. 57 is a K. Tough break for Kuzman there in the fourth. And it's 3-2 Giants with Marichal on the mound in the fifth. Joe Foy, 1-6 is a walk. A Steeler, plus one arm catcher. God, it's so tempting. He almost went either a hit. Foy is an A. Who else is an A? AG's a B. Harrelson's an A. If you get thrown out twice, you can't steal anymore. I might want to keep that attempt in my back pocket and save it for later in case I want to steal a base in the latter part of this game. All right, so he'll hold for Wayne Garrett. 65, center C. Cleon Jones. Plus, if you recall, Cleon Jones held up in this inning and Singleton got a base hit on a double play ball. So that's what the Mets are hoping for here. Cleon Jones, the runner at first and one out. 2-8, and he just misses the plus. Let's take a look at Cleon's card. There's the Cleon Jones 340 card of 1969. 2-7 would have been a single, but 2-8 is a 5-4-3 double play. Tough break for the Mets. And it's 3-2 going to the bottom of the fifth. Let's pause a moment for station identification.
This is the Shrimp Trawler video channel.
Este es el canal de videos de camaroneros.
Sorry, folks. I had to go run to the other room for some refreshing beverage and didn't make it back in time. Normally, I have the water by the broadcast booth. Anyway, bottom of the fifth, 3-2 Giants. It's Willie McCovey. 64 off Kuzman's a bouncer to short. This is Harrelson, a 1E17, and he's out. McCovey's kind of quiet this series. And if he wakes up, look out. Ken Henderson, 2-5, base hit. Bonds, 2-3, base hit because you held the runner on base. So, see, it works. It's worked a couple times in this game for each team. Runners on the corners for Jose Herrera. We're going to bring the infield up. 35. Let's take a look at Herrera's card. He hits very well against lefties. 286 overall. Did it with the Expos in 69. This is single 1-17, and that's a base hit, and it's suddenly 4-2 Giants. So suddenly the Giants are getting some breaks that they didn't get in games 1, 2, and 3 as they try and come back. Tito Fuentes, first and second, one out. 58, bouncer to second. Wayne Garrett's a 3-E-10. And that's a double play. 4-2, Giants in the sixth. Marischal, not going anywhere. Kenny Singleton leading off the sixth inning. 49, bouncer to second. Hunt's a 3-19, he makes the play. Tommy A.G., 58. Short X, this is Spire, 2-E-22, makes the play. And Ed Cranepool, 59, second C. Bottom of the sixth, it's Chris Spire. 1-11, grounds a short. Ron Hunt, 59, short X, again, 1-E-17. No chance. And with two outs, Dick Dietz, 32, short A. You know, another thing that the in the Giants-Red series was generally bad defense. We talked about Concepcion's woes. He was a 3-48. Bud Harrelson's a 1-E-17 at short. You got no shot, and that can just kill a team. We saw earlier this year, Bud Harrelson had six X's in a game with Matlack on the mound. Forget which game that was. So it's 4-2 in the seventh inning. Giants, no defense to bring in. Yeah. We go to the seventh inning. It's Clendenon. 6-10, third X. Oh boy, 3-37. And there's an error as soon as I talk about it. The tie run is Bud Harrelson. 43 off Marischal, left X, but the outfield's good. A 2-E-12. And that is caught. One out. Jerry Grody to the max. 2A, let's take a look at Jerry Grody's card. He bangs one on over the third baseman's head. It rolls down in the corner, but it'll hold. It'll be a single. You got runners on the corners with one out, a two-run lead for Marischal. Joe Foy's the batter. With a two-run lead, and Marischal, they're going to play it back. No speed except for Harrelson at third. Joe Foy, 4-12, left B, sack fly. That's a nice break for the Mets. They get an unearned run with two outs now. It's Wayne Garrett in a 4-3 game. The pitch. 1-9, Wayne Garrett. Double 1-16 is a double. Second and third, and it's two outs. Let's show you the Cleon Jones card again. Marischal's a starter 9. He's not going anywhere. One of the ceremonial things the Giants do is when he takes the mound in the ninth inning, they turn the lights off in the bullpen, and he yanks a cord down like he's turning the lights off to signify it. Turn the lights off in the bullpen, nobody's coming in. But we're a little bit away from that. Anyway, it's second and third with two outs in the seventh. Cleon Jones, Juan Marischal, huge moment here. The pitch to Cleon Jones. 53 off Marischal, right X. You can't get on. Right fielder is a 1-E-2. Good luck with that. Yeah. Impossible. So Bobby Bonds squeezes that one. And it's a 4-3 game. Bottom of the seventh, stretch time in San Francisco. We've been listening to Moby Grapes, The Place and the Time, a compilation of auditions, remasters, studio takes, and bloopers and whatnot from The Great Grape. All this stuff is copyright free. You can listen to this all day. It's 2 hours, an hour and 15 minutes. Try listen to any of their actual releases. Good luck with that. All right, bottom of the seventh. Kuzman, starter 9. He's not going anywhere. It'll be Willie Mays leading off. 69, center. Willie McCovey, 57's a K. Ken Henderson, 49 is a K. We go to the eighth. Marischal Kuzman, nail biter, 4-3 game. Ken Singleton leads off the eighth inning for the Mets. 65, sky's the center. Tommy A.G., 2-7 is a K, and with two outs, it's easy Ed Cranepool. 2-6, let's take a look at Cranepool's card. Nice year for him in 71. Hit 280 with 14 bombs, platoon player only. But they're able to get him and Clendenon both in the game at the same time. It's a big advantage for the Mets. That's a base hit in the center field. And here is Don Clendenon, who homered earlier. The pitch to Don Clendenon. 45 off Marischal. Triple one and two to tie it. It's a single dot dot. And the Mets, again, they've got runners on the corners with two outs for the second inning in a row. Marischal, he doesn't care. And it's Bud Harrelson with the runners on the corners and two outs in the eighth inning. The pitch to Bud Harrelson. 2-9 is a strikeout. All right, bottom of the eighth. Kuzman kind of got deflated here when he could have had an inning-ending double play, but instead they couldn't get the double play at first, and you get a two-out hit. That's the difference of the game. It's kind of a cheesy way to be losing if you're Kuzman. He's not really happy about that. But in the bottom of the eighth, Bobby Bonds leads off. 2-11, grounds to third. This will be a controversial World playoffs. Because in Game 3, it was bringing Sam McDowell, taking him out of the game with a one-hit shutout because he was injured and causing the Giants to lose. And now in Game 4, we have some more controversy with Kuzman giving up a couple of runs here in the fourth. Anyway, Jose Herrera, 55, off of Kuzman, triple, one, a two, single. Tito Fuentes, 2-11, lines the third, and Chris Spire. 68, flies to left field. We go to the ninth. No defense to bring in. It's Grody, Foy, and Garrett in the ninth for the Mets. Here we go. Jerry Grody, the pitch. 2-6 is a liner to second. Joe Foy. 46 off Marischal. Double, one of seven. He gets the double on the five. And for the third consecutive inning, the Mets have a tie or lead run in scoring position. Foley is at second for Wayne Garrett, and then Cleon Jones, Singleton AG, and Crane Pool. I mean, this is, hey, it's not the big red machine, but it's pretty darn good. Wayne Garrett, we looked at his card yet? He had a double in this game. Let's take a look at Wayne Garrett's card. Pretty nice card in 1970 again. A lot of times the Mets players were actually better in 70 than they were in 69. That's the case with Garrett. It's a lot of power, a lot of on base versus righties, and you don't play him versus lefties. So no bigger moment now for Wayne Garrett with a tying run at second base and one out in the ninth inning. The pitch to Wayne Garrett. 2-4, skies to center field, and with two outs, it's going to come down to Cleon Jones. Cleon Jones with a tying run at second and two outs in the ninth inning. The pitch to Cleon Jones. 67 off Marischal is a strikeout, and the Giants get a win. And that will snap the Mets' momentum. A tough loss for the Mets here after getting some tough wins in 2 and 3. Third consecutive one-run game, and the Giants have made this a series. 4-3 is your final. Marischal gets the complete game. Kuzman gets the complete game. Game 5, the final game in San Francisco, and then Game 6 and 7 will be in Shea Stadium if necessary. Your Game 5 starters will be Tom Seaver in Candlestick versus Ron Bryant. And we'll take a break and be back with that game. Welcome back, baseball fans. Game 5. Mets let one slip away in Game 4. Couldn't quite get the sweep. We're back in Candlestick in Game 5. It'll be for the Mets, Tom Seaver, and for the Giants, Ron Bryant. Let's get started in the first inning. Tommy AG, 45 off Bryant is a sky to right. Pat Crowley, 65, double one to 15 is a single. Ken Singleton now batting third against a lefty. 3-5, single one. Lines out the short on a two. And with two outs, Cleon Jones. 1-5, Cleon Jones. Let's take a look at the card. I guess I got to show the cards in each game I play here. We saw it last game. But anyway, the big year in 69 for Cleon. He'll never do this again. 1-5, that is a two-run homer. And just like last game, the Mets get out to an early lead. They've had the lead in 5 straight games. Clendenon, 37's a walk. And Joe Foy, 1-5, flies to left. Terrific Tom Seaver, given a 2-0 lead and a potential closeout game in Candlestick Park. The Giants shuffle their lineup again a little bit. They have their third consecutive different leadoff hitter in this game. Now it's Ken Henderson. The ace stealer is now leading off against the righty Seaver. The pitch to Ken Henderson, 34, rounds to the pitcher. Tito Fuentes, another lefty batting second. 2-6 is a single. Willie Mays, 3-11, short B. He runs it out at first. So runner at first, two outs from a Covey. 45 off Seaver, triple 1-5, single dot dot is a single dot dot. And with two outs, the new number 5 hitter is Jim Hart. Let's take a look at him before he bats. His first start in the series at DH, and they also are giving Fran Healy a start at catcher instead of Dick Dietz, as Dietz demolishes lefties, not so good against right, not as good against righties. So here is Jim Hart in a big moment. With runners on the corners and two outs in the first inning, the pitch to Jim Hart, 1-9, hits the column, double 1-15 is the double. And just like that, the Giants come right back. It's 2-1. Second and third, with two outs, Bobby Bonds, 1-10, is a single to left field. McCovey scores. Hart is a 12-runner, 13-14, against the Cleon Jones arm of minus one. Now, home team is just my decision. I can decide to run guys or not run guys based on how I feel at the moment. And I'm going to run him. It's 13 with a guy who doesn't get a lot of hits on his card, Hunt, next. So it's 1-13 here to give the Giants a lead. And he runs and advances on a 2. So it is a 2-run single. Now the road team rule is you have to have a 14 or better success chance to run. But the home team can run it on a 13, a 12, 11, 10, 9, whatever it wants to do. So that's the rule I play for home field advantage. And that helps the Giants get a 3-2 lead. Bonds at first. We still got Grody catching. He'll probably catch the whole series. And he'll play the, you have to platoon or rest your catchers in this. So, you know, you got to have a minus 3 arm in there. Just like Johnny Bench doesn't get rested for the Reds. Same thing with Grody. So Ron Hunt, with the speedy Bonds at first, will bat. 36 is a walk, or hit by pitch. And with two outs, it's Fran Healy. 58 off Seaver is a K. So Giants take a 3-2 lead in the bottom of the first in windy Candlestick. Bud Harrelson leads off in the second off Bryant. 47, skies a center. Bobby Heiss, 2-9, grounds a short. Jerry Grody to the max, 6-10, bounces to third. We know he's not good. 3-37, and that's an error. Tommy A.G. 1-10, skies the center field. Bottom of the second, Chris Spire, 58 is a K. Ken Henderson, 57 is a K. And Fuentes is a K plus an injury. Well, suddenly the defensive woes of the Giants third baseman get worse as the 3E37 Fuentes will leave. Hart will simply go to third base as a 4E37. And our new number 2 hitter will be a right-handed hitter with power on the bench. That's not Hallenier. That's not Jose Herrera. It'll be Dick Dietz. Thought we were giving him a day off, but he's pressed into service because Seaver has a little bit of difficulty keeping the ball in the ballpark. Just to check on that, Seaver gave up 24 homers in 1969. So Dietz will be in the Fuente spot at DH. Hart goes to third, and Healy will be the new DH. Healy be the DH. Hart goes to third, and the guy just said Dietz is the catcher. Okay, enough of that. Top of the third, in Candlestick, 3-2 Giants. It'll be Pat Corrales, 6-10, bouncer to third. 4-37. And that's a double. Well, that's a good start for the Mets. Hit it there. Hit it there. Ken Singleton with a runner at second. 5-11. Short X. Now Spires are all right. He's a 2-22. He makes the play, but the runner goes to third. Heads up running by Pat Corrales. He runs to third on the throw to first. So you got a runner at third with one out. They're going to bring it up for Cleon Jones. 2-10 is a base hit because you brought it up for Cleon Jones. And that is a single RBI on the plus. So, just like that, the Mets have tied the game in the third. Don Clendenon. 1-10 is a 6-4-3 double play. Very strange game early on. It's 3-3 in the bottom of the third. Willie Mays. 66 off Seavers, a K. McCovey. 2-6 is a base hit. That breaks a string of five consecutive strikeouts for Seaver. Jim Hart, 47. Double 1-7, sky to center, and he gets the double off the Seaver car. That's a tough break for Tom there. McCovey will hold at third. So if you're Seaver, you got to get these outs on your card. You got Homer 1-6. Let's look at Seaver's card again. It's a lot like the Bill Singer card, if you remember me talking about how great Bill Singer was in 69. But Seaver will actually have better years than this, believe it or not. 1-6 fly ball on 5, and then a double 1-7, the single 1-6, and against a lefty single 1. You got to get those outs to get a shutout and so forth. Here it's a double, and it's second and third with one out in a tie game. And the Mets are going to bring the infield up for Bobby Bonds, who has only, he's got some pluses on his card. 38 is a K. And Ron Hunt, 36 is another hit by pitch for that guy. Bases loaded, two outs for Fran Healy. 39 is a walk, and that's an RBI. And with the bases loaded and two outs, it's Chris Spier. 2-6 is another walk. Now, with all these walks, we are getting close to breaking Seaver with the number one bases through three innings. If you get to 12 in three, or you get 8 hits and 4 walks, or 10 hits, something like that, you're broken. So let's count these. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, two more, and then we'll call them broken. But it's 5-3, though. Real shaky start here for Ken Henderson. Two outs in the third inning. 5-10 is catcher's card. This is where Grody could really help out his pitcher. It's a 2-5. Don't get that pass ball. And you get a wild pitch. Oh, well. Well, not the best inning for Tom. That'll score a run on the wild pitch plus foul out. Some shoddy baseball in Game 5 in Candlestick, and the Giants take a 6-3 lead. Into the fourth inning. Joe Foy, 39 is a walk. Bud Harrelson, gosh, I want to do a hit and run here. Down three runs. I'm going to do it. Bud Harrelson can't hit. Let's take a look at Bud Harrelson's card. He doesn't hit lefties well at all, but he's a B hit and runner. We need a break here for the Mets. The hit and run. It's a 6, and he removes the runner up. Would have been a double play. All right, so we got a runner at second for Bobby Heiss. 67 is a single 1-5 off Bryant, and he lines out. And with two outs, it's Jerry Grody to the max. 1-7 is a fly to left field. 6-3, bottom of the fourth. It's Dick Dietz now in the two spot. 57's a K. Willie Mays. 59 is short X. This is Harrelson on 1-17, and he's out. And with two outs, it's McCovey. 43, pitcher X, Seaver is a E11. And the inning's over. Top of the fifth. 6-3. Tommy AG. 3-6 will be a walk. Not going to steal. Pat Corrales, let's take a look at his card. Unusual player in that he played for the Reds in 69 with this particular card. He was available. The Mets were looking for a backup for Grody, and they found that Corrales, man, that's a nice on base percentage, really both ways. And they like him batting second. And it's been working thus far this year. They're in the National League Championship Series, him batting second all year against lefties. So here's the pitch to Pat Corrales. 55 is a K. Ken Singleton. 2-4 is a K, and with two outs, it's Cleon Jones. Same roll, 2-4, flies a left. Bottom of the fifth. Before we do that, let's pause a moment for station identification.
This is the Shrimp Trawler video channel.
Este es el canal de videos de camaroneros.
All right, bottom of the fifth, it's Jim Hart. 62, pitcher. Bobby Bonds, 111, short. And Ron Hunt, 45, off Seaver. Homer, 1-6, fly ball, and it's a fly ball. If you remember, Hunt hit two home run chances off Seaver in game two that were singles because he doesn't have power. We go to the sixth. Mets down three. It's Clendenon. 110, short. Joe Foley, 58, short X. This is Spire, 2E22. Makes the play. And Bud Harrelson. 312 is left B plus injury. Well, they are down by three. I don't know if they need their defense that much. So they lose a shortstop. And you got to put Wayne Garrett at... Bobby Heiss was playing second base. He'll play short where he's a 348. Wayne Garrett will play second where he's a 310, and Foy stays in the game. All right, so the Mets defense just got a little lousy suddenly. In a 6-3 game, Fran Healy, 59, short X. You hit it to the guy who replaces the injured Bud Harrelson, but he makes the play. Nice play, Heiss. Chris Spire, 412 left. And Ken Henderson, 2-8, grounds to second base. We go to the seventh. The story today is Ron Bryant, folks. While Seaver's been two bad innings in between, he struck five guys out in a row. I can't figure Seaver out. He's been having a really strange year. 6-3 in the seventh, but Ron Bryant, a two-run homer in the first, a single in the third, that's it. He's throwing a nifty four-hitter in an elimination game. His final game of the series. Then they'll have McDowell in six and Dean Chance in seven. So Marichal and Bryant will be done. So here's Bobby Heiss in the seventh inning. 32, pops a second. Jerry Grody, 311. Fly ball to right, B plus injury. Grody's hurt. Well, we know he got Pat Corrales the catch. Frank Johnson will go into the Grody spot to play right field, and Singleton will go into the DH spot. And with two outs, it's Tommy A.G. Strange game. 56, bouncer to second. He's a 319 at second base, and he makes the play. Stretch time and Candlestick. Giants fans getting rowdy, sensing the comeback. Down 0-3. Two very spirited games here. And we are listening to Sly and the Family Stone. There's a riot going on, pretty much. If the Giants win this one, it looks like they're on their way. And I want to play spoiler back in Shea Stadium. Sly and the Family Stone, riot going on from 1971. It's a family affair, yada yada. Bottom of the seventh. Seaver still out there. It'll be Dick Dietz. 2-6 off the Dietz card is double 1-12, double. Willie Mays, 66 is a K. McCovey, 55, bounces to short X again. They know where Bud Harrelson is no more, and that is an RBI single, something you could not do before the injury, and now it's 7-3. Oh boy, momentum has clearly changed in this series. Jim Hart, 1-8, triple, 1! And he rolled the one, gets the triple and an RBI. And I think this, the Mets got their suitcases packed. They want to win in front of their own fans. It's quite obvious here. Bonds, 33, grounds to short. And with two outs, Ron Hunt, hit by pitch. Fran Healy, 1-7 is a K. It's 8-3 in the eighth inning. But Ron Bryant's not coming out, not with this giant bullpen. It was a mess against the Reds and a mess in Game 3. I think they've painfully learned their lesson. They're going to stay with their starters until they break. Pat Corrales, or get injured. 47, Sky's the center. Ken Singelen, 44, center X. This is Willie Mays. He makes the catch. Leon Jones, 48, pops a short. Bottom of the eighth, Seaver is not going to take the mound. He's had enough. And this is the rare opportunity for the very rare Bill Zepp sighting. Let's take a look at Bill Zepp. He's the eighth Met. He's the fifth Beatle. He's Shemp. He's the extra guy on the Mets pitching staff that's actually not even a member of the New York Mets. He pitched for the Minnesota Twins in 1970 to a tune of 9-4, the 3.22 ERA in 151 innings. And the Mets said, we'll take him. As the eighth pitcher on the staff, who only plays in blowouts and so forth. So he comes on in the eighth to face Chris Spire. Grounder to short. Ken Henderson, 44. Catcher's card. This is Corrales, 2-9. By the way, those injured players will be back. When you get injured in a game, you just come back for the next game. It's never longer than that. And Dick Dietz, 49. Single 1-10. Gets the single. And Willie Mays, 69. Double 1-9 is a double. And Willie McCovey, 2-6 is a single. Mays will hold up at third base. As the Giants are pouring it on, Jim Hart, 2-10 left. Bryant gone for the complete game in the ninth inning. 9-3 affair. Don Clendenon, Sky's a left. Joe Foy, catcher's card. Dietz is a 3-8. That's an out. And Wayne Garrett for the injured Harrelson. That's a single. Put in the wrong spot. And Bobby Heiss, 68, is a walk. Trying to break him with two outs in the ninth inning. Here's Frank Johnson for the injured Grody. 57 is a K. They could not break him. If he was broken, that would have been a single. They could not do it. And the Giants, much like in the American League, the Tigers are up 3-0 and the Red Sox won the next two games. So it's very similar. Of course, the home and roads are different. A complete game for Ron Bryant. He wins 9-3. Seaver pitches 7 innings. Zepp pitches an inning. The teams will get on a plane and fly back to Shea Stadium for Game 6. It'll be the last time we see the great starting pitchers of each squad. It'll be John Matlack and Sam McDowell in Game 6. If the Giants win that game, Game 7 is all relief pitchers and the number 4 starters, Cardwell and Dean Chance. So this thing could get nutty if the Mets don't close out the Giants in Game 6. And we'll be back with that game shortly. Welcome back, baseball fans. This is Game 6, the National League Championship Series, back in Shea Stadium in New York, where the Mets are hoping that their home raucous fans will help them get a win and finish this thing. They've got the better defense, the better bullpen, and mostly the better pitching. For today, though, for the Giants, it'll be Sam McDowell, who one-hit the Mets in Game 3 before an injury took him out earlier than expected. And for the Mets, it'll be John Matlack, who has been the best pitcher for the Mets all year. And it's up to him to do what Kuzman and Seaver could not. And that is put the Mets in the World Series. Let's get started from Shea Stadium. Ken Henderson has taken hold of the leadoff spot after last game. He leads off with a strikeout plus injury. That's different. So, they need a left fielder, do they? Well, Jose Herrera is the DH, and he can play left field. So he'll come in. And I guess we'll just put Jim Hart. Actually, Jim Hart can also play left field. He plays the worst. We'll just put Jim Hart in that spot. Well, that's not what the Giants wanted. They lost a good defensive left fielder and a spark plug, an ace stealer. Ron Hunt, 46, sky's the center. Willie Mays, 2-5, strikes out, returns to New York. It's a nice ovation from the New Yorkers here, we think. Bottom of the first, Tommy A.G., 65, bounces the second. Pat Corrales, 67's a K. Kenny Singleton, 1-6 is a base hit. And with two outs in the first, it's Cleon Jones, 1-5! I think we looked at the card in every game, gotta look at it again. Can't remember what I said last time. Something about he'll never do this again, blah, 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 blah. Two-run shot for Cleon James, and for the sixth consecutive game, the Mets have the lead. 2-0 at home. Don Clendenon, 5-11 is a walk. And with two outs, it's Joe Foy, 63, second X. He's a 3-E-19 at second base, makes the play. The Mets can take advantage of the Giant defense at Shea. They hope. In a 2-0 game with a young Matlack. Dick Dietz, 48, pops to first. Willie McCovey, 66, single 1-6. And he gets it. That's a big break for McCovey. Bobby Bonds, 57's a K. And with two outs, it's Fuentes. 1-3, grounds a third. Bottom of two. Bud Harrelson, 54, center B. Bobby Heiss, 52, left B. Jerry Grody, 59, short X. This is Spire, 2E22 at short. And a cheap single off Spire. Grody's out. On at first for Tommy A.G. with two outs. 56 is a K. Whoops. Tommy A.G. just fell on the floor. That's not good. You broke the rhythm there, Tommy. This card just jumped out of the stack and ruined all the momentum I had. Okay, third inning here. Jose Herrera. 68 off of Matlack is a K. Chris Spire, 5-10 is a catcher's card. Grody's a 2-E-5. And that's an out. And Ken Henderson, or not Ken Henderson, Jim Hart, 6-10. Short X, first ground ball of many to Buddy Harrelson today, and that's an out. We go to the bottom of the third. It's Pat Corrales, 33. Sky's to right. Kenny Singleton, 67, is a K. And with two outs, it's Cleon Jones. 2-8 is a K. Top of the fourth, Ron Hunt, 65, off of the Matlack card. Triple singles, a base hit. Willie Mays, 37, is a walk. 2-1 for Dick Dietz. This is the trouble spot here, the Dietz-McCovey thing. 57 is a K. And the dangerous Willie McCovey, having a quiet series, has some hits, but no homers. Short X! This is a double play! Matlack and Harrelson. Matlack has been buying six-pack after six-pack for Bud Harrelson after games, as he just gobbles up these ground ball double plays. And, you get the idea, folks. Two-zip, bottom of the fourth. It's Don Clendenon leading off. 45, triple 1-4, single. Joe Foy, 49 is a K. Bud Harrelson, what's Clendenon's a C? Do we do a hit and run here? Let's do a hit and run up two. Moves runner up. That's not bad. Runner at second with two outs for Bob Heiss. 5-12 is a K. All right, they tried to move the runner up, didn't work, but they have a 2-0 lead in the fifth for Bobby Bonds. 2-5, grounds are short. Tito Fuentes, 37's a K. Jose Herrera, 67, single 1-14. He lines out on a 17. Matlack with five shutout innings. It'll be Jerry Grody in the fifth. 47, single 1-7. He doesn't get it. Tommy A.G., 55, second X. He's a 3-E-19 at second base. That Giant defense again, a base hit. B Steeler plus one arm catcher. But no, I'm not going to run out of an inning here. I have a 2-0 lead, so Corrales will hit away. 64, short X. Oh boy, this could be interesting. He's a 2E22 at short and an error on Spire. And oh my goodness, the Giant defense at the worst time, down 2-0 in game 6. You got 2 on now after the error, with 1 out for Kenny Singleton. 47, single 1-7 off of McDowell, and he lines out. And with 2 outs, big at bat here for Cleon Jones, with 2 on and 2 out in the 5th. The pitch to Cleon, 410, center X. This is Willie Mays. He's a 2E10 in center field, and he makes the catch. He's made plenty of catches in New York, the Polo Grounds, I guess, right? All right, let's go to the 6th inning. It's Chris Spire. 47's a K. Jim Hart. 57 is a K. Ron Hunt. 48. Ron Hunt pops to first base. Matlack with a 2-hit shutout through 6. Mets up 2-0. Finally, been waiting for a well-pitched game from somebody. And we finally get one. 2-0. Bottom of the 6th. It'll be Clendenon. 2-9 is a single. Joe Foy. 1-7 is a K. Bud Harrelson. Do I do it again? Oh, let's do another hit and run. It almost worked last time. Oh, no, that's not what you want. That's the double play one, right? Yeah, that's not what you wanted. That's the double play. So, not what you want to be doing with a 2-0 lead, but Buddy Harrelson just lined into a double play on the hit and run. Okay, well, that's all right. He's only a rookie, folks. We're just going to put our entire franchise on the broad shoulders of John Matlack here. He's got 9 outs to get with a brilliant bullpen behind him. And the Mets are, you should think about some defense here. And they will. So Foy will leave third base and they will put Garrett in for him. And they're going to take out Corrales. They don't need him anymore. And they'll put Frank Johnson in for him. So now they got the full complement of defense everywhere with 9 outs to get to go to the World Series. Willie Mays, a leadoff in the 7th inning. 2-9 is a K. Dick Dietz, 47 is a K. And with 2 outs, the dangerous Willie McCovey. Could be his final at-bat of the series. Willie McCovey, 57. You guessed it. 3 fingers, folks. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 strikeouts for John Matlack, his 72 rookie card. It's 15-10 with a 2.32 ERA. Kuzman had a 2.28 ERA. Seaver had a 2.21 ERA. Not much difference, really. And Matlack has been the best pitcher this year, and it continues into game 6. It's just 2-0. Sam McDowell, a 2-run homer to Cleon James, has been it in 12 innings of pitching in this series. And he's going to continue into the bottom of the 7th. Bobby Heiss, 6-12, first C. Jerry Grody, 1-9 is a walk. Tommy A.G., 36 is a walk, 2 on for Frank Johnson. Interesting that, let's take a look at Frank Johnson. We haven't seen him much. Frank Johnson was a San Francisco Giant, oddly enough, in 1970. The Mets selected him to be corner outfield defense for Singleton. And he has the same kind of card that the Pat Corrales had, if you saw his card in either this game or the last game, the 1-2 card with walks. So here's a big moment for Frank Johnson with 2 on and 1 out in the 7th inning. The pitch to Frank Johnson. 54, center B, not an X. And with 2 outs, it's Ken Singleton, now at DH. Ken Singleton, 3-11 is a walk, and that doesn't break McDowell. McDowell's a starter 8, folks. So you got Sam McDowell, a starter 8, pulled early in game 3 before. Now we're going to hang on to him probably too long. We're just going to leave him in there with a bases loaded and 2 outs. After the 2-run homer to Cleon Jones in the first, he's given up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9 base runners, none have scored, but here's Cleon. Let's flash the card up there again. He's not McCovey, but he's pretty darn close. As far as batting average, he out-hits McCovey by 20 points. So it's Cleon Jones with the bases loaded and 2 outs. The pitch to Cleon Jones. 35 is single out, dot a 2-run single on the Mets and Cleon Jones. It's Cleon 4, Giants nothing, and the Mets are starting to feel this. They got a 4-0 lead with 2 outs and runners on the corners. And it's Clendenon. Let's take a look at the Clendenon card. Destroys lefties, but we're going to stick with our guy McDowell after what happened last time and after how terrible the Giant bullpen has been. And they're down 4-0 anyway. So it's Clendenon. The pitch to Don Clendenon. 1-8, and he skies the center field. McDowell gets out of it, giving up just the 2 runs. But you got John Matlack, 6 outs away. And let me count the number of batters till Willie McCovey bats again. Well, you know what? Willie McCovey made the final at bat. So at some point in the 8th or 9th inning, I could flip over to Tug McGraw. If I want to get some righties out, I can go to Acosta. If I want to get some switch hitters out, I could go to Danny Frisella. Ken Anderson's already out of the game. He's a switch hitter, so only Fuentes would be a danger. And he'd be batting right-handed anyway. So, with a 4-0 lead, Matlack is the maestro. He'll take the mound in the 8th against Bobby Bonds. The pitch, 56, is a bouncer to second base. He is a 2 at second base, and Bobby Heiss makes the play. The Mets. I forgot to mention, we've been listening to Lou Reed. He's at the game, sitting behind the bench, hanging out with Laurie, his wife. Damn. Laurie such and such. I hate messing that up. Anyway, you get the idea. I'll figure it out like with 5 minutes left in the broadcast. Anyway, Tito Fuentes, 2-7 is a single. Pearl Bailey's at the game, I recall. Pearl Bailey being at, 69 Mets, that makes sense. All right, Jose Herrera, 45, skies the center, and with 2 outs, Chris Spire. 68 is a strikeout, number 12 for Matlack. The shutout continues. It's 4-0 in the 8th inning. McDowell pitched to Wayne Garrett because he's left-handed to lead off in the 8th. 35 is a ground ball to second. Now you got Harrelson and Heiss. Harrelson and Heiss aren't much, so he'll just continue. Harrelson, 111, pops to second. Bobby Heiss, 1-3, lines to third, but here we are, folks, in the 9th inning. The Mets, 3 outs away from going to the World Series. Matlack, the entire bullpen is available. They need 3 outs to go to the World Series. It's Jim Hart, Ron Hunt, Willie Mays, 3 straight righties. Hal Lanier is available for what that's worth. McCovey's the 5th batter in this inning. But Matlack's not going anywhere. He is no danger of breaking. Jim Hart leads off in the 9th. The pitch to Jim Hart. 5-10 is catcher's card. Grody's a 2-E-5, and he makes the play. Ron Dogwell Hunt. The pitch to Ron Hunt. 38 is a hit by the pitch. It's Willie Mays. And as he steps in the box, he gets a nice ovation from the New York fans. Willie Mays. 112 is a strikeout for Willie Mays, and the season is in the hands of Dick Dietz, and McCovey cannot tie the game either. So, with 2 outs in the 9th inning, the pitch to Dick Dietz. 1-5 is ball 4 off the Dietz card. And here is McCovey. And he actually has more homers against righties, obviously. And this is going to be the final batter for Matlack, as he's better against lefties, of course, than Tug McGraw. So it's up to Willie McCovey. Let's show you the card for possibly the final time. Willie McCovey against John Matlack in the top of the 9th. The pitch, 1-6, McCovey Jackson down the right field line, it's gone! And suddenly there's a murmur at Shea Stadium. Hold the phone, folks. Hold the phone here. Hold on, Lou. Hold on here. There's a murmur at the stadium. It's 4-3 with two outs in the ninth inning. And there's going to be a pitching change. So Matlack runs out of gas. And it'll be Bobby Bonds in the ninth with two outs. And the pitcher of choice, you have two options. You could go to Acosta or McGraw. And McGraw, yeah, you got to go McGraw. So Tug McGraw is coming in from the bullpen. The music gets playing again here. Tug McGraw is going to take the mound in the ninth inning against Bobby Bonds. With two outs in the ninth, the pitch to Bobby Bonds. 2-4 is a sky to center field. Tommy A.G. makes the catch. The New York Mets are going to the World Series. The Miracle Mets of 1969. A near heart attack in the ninth. They left the kid in there just a smidge too long, but Tug McGraw gets his third save of the series. Here we go. This is a great tune. Satellite Love. All right. Complete game. A complete game for McDowell and a loss. A third save in the series for Tug McGraw. Final box. McGraw gets the one out. A fly ball by Bonds with two outs and nobody on base. Matlack does get the win. Four hits, three runs, all the ninth. That were earned thanks to William McCovey making this interesting. Walk three, struck out 13. Probably gets disqualified for one of the best pitching performances of all time because of that stupid homer. But if it would have thrown a shutout, that would have been very memorable there. Sam McDowell, hard Scrabble loss there. Seven hits in eight innings. The four runs were all earned. Cleon Jones did all the damage. Four walks, seven strikeouts in a complete game. 1019, 0108, 4734. 313, 47. And we'll do the composite box. Laurie Anderson. Told you I remember. He married Laurie Anderson. So that was the answer to that trivia question. So, there we go. The Mets and the Giants. The Giants have won more games than any team in baseball because they've played more games than any team in baseball. We'll look at some of the year-to-date numbers in the standings section as well once we get this box going. And we'll look at the pitching matchups for the World Series. So the Mets are 29-16, hitting .255 with a .312 ERA that keeps falling and falling. Eventually it might get under three. John Matlack, 9-2, has given up 17 earned runs in 81 innings to a 1.88 ERA. Unfortunately, he won't pitch in game one of the World Series. We'll figure out who that will be. 29-16, and oh boy, folks, Tigers Mets. If you like starting pitching and left-handed closers, that's gonna be a fun World Series. Can't wait. 29-16. Giants finished 31-24, hitting .263 with a .372 ERA. And when we look at the year-to-date records for the final teams, let's start in the American League. Boston finishes 28-14, but they got knocked out in the championship series by a Tigers team who was 29-25. We talked about their struggles in the regular season. Nothing of note in the American League Central and West. Now, in the National League East, of course, your Mets are 29-16. Percentage points behind the Reds and the Red Sox, but those guys are sitting home, and the Mets are playing some baseball. In the West, tough year for the Giants to see it all end like it did. They won 31 of 55 games. Wow, that's a long season. They had to play extra playoff round because they were wild card. 31-24, 55 games played. The Tigers, 54 games played. And the Mets have only played 45 games because they had a bye. So let's take a look now at your World Series, the early look at the matchup, pitching matchups for the World Series. We didn't have that Game 7 mess we thought we were going to have. It's Kuzman. It has to be. Jerry Kuzman and Kuzman. This might work out perfectly. Yep, it is. For the Mets, Kuzman's going to pitch 3 World Series games. He'll pitch Game 1, then a day off. Then it'll be Seaver. Then it'll be Matlack. Then it'll be Kuzman again in Game 4. Then it'll be Don Cardwell making his only start in Game 6. And then it'll be Seaver again, excuse me, Game 5 and Game 6. And then it'll be Kuzman in Game 7. Which means that Jerry Kuzman, and here's Detroit up here, way up there at the very top. So Kuzman and Coleman will be dance partners 3 times. Tom Seaver, Mickey Lolich will be dance partners twice. Danny McClain and John Matlack once. Then we'll have Les Cain and Don Cardwell in that odd Game 5. A couple of things to note for Matlack, depending on what he does in Game 3. We could actually... Not against Danny McClain now. I was saying we could let him go to the bullpen and be devastating with McGraw. Tub McGraw and Matlack together in the bullpen, that's insane. And we could put Cardwell here and Matlack there and have Matlack pitch in relief. But he just pitched there, so we're just going to leave it alone. We'll take our chances. Cardwell, Les Cain, that'll be an interesting game. But talk about guys. Coleman, Lolich, and McClain are all starter nines. Kuzman's a starter 9, Seaver's a starter 8, Matlack's a starter 7. Met bullpen's a little bit deeper, of course. Tigers have their lefty closer, John Hiller, not as good as Tug McGraw. And the Mets also have Frizzella and Acosta. Tigers-Mets. Boy, that's a fun one. The Tigers won the 1968 World Series, Mets won the 1969 World Series. And folks, you're going to see both teams better. They're going to be a better roster than the 2 rosters that participated in those World Series games. All right, that's it tonight. Thanks for checking it out. We'll have a World Series preview coming soon. We'll see you next time.